sue that drunk person and get back all the damages caused to them. And we want to incentivize people not to put themselves in situations where they're going to be harmed by other people. So we might not want to give them the full compensation for the harm that was caused. And you'll be dealing with this a lot more on your problem set. So the Anglo-Saxon legal system basically incorporates the idea of pigou almost directly, right? Just the whole idea is that you have to pay for the harms that you cause. And that's exactly pigou's principle. And the idea behind the common law, which is the Anglo-Saxon system, is that not everything can be covered in government statutes. It's just too hard for government to charge taxes for or find other pigouvian solutions to all problems, right? There's just too many problems for the government to write enough laws. On the other hand, the Europeans think that we have way too many lawsuits, and they write many, many, many more laws and regulate things much, much more specifically than we do. And these are sort of two different ways of dealing with the externality problems. The US believes much more in paying for the cost that you impose on other people. The Europeans believe much more in directly regulating certain behaviors to be illegal. So they're much more similar to the solution that economists are sort of skeptical of, which is the direct regulation that, you know, just says you can't do this, you can't do this, whereas the US system is much more similar to the economist solution. So even though a lot of right-wing people say that we have way too many lawsuits, in some ways that exactly reflects the fact that we're using a much more market-oriented system than the Europeans are. So instead of mandating a particular quantity price that we place on an activity, you could also mandate a quantity and then allow people to trade. For example, you could auction off the right to pollute. You could say anytime you pollute, you need to have this little certificate that says it was okay for me to pollute. And you can auction off the right to those permits. Or you could say anyone who doesn't build a beautiful house has to have a permit, right? And then you could auction off the right to those for a negative externality, for a positive externality. So let's return to the smoking example. So pigou would put a tax of $0.9, sorry, on each cigarette. But an alternative would be to cap the total number of cigarettes sold at 55,000, which is the efficient number, right? So now imagine that the supply of cigarettes were perfectly inelastic at 55,000 and that the demand were given by what we just did before, which was 5 times 3 minus the price, right? That's the demand function that just comes out of that equation over there. What would the equilibrium price of cigarettes be, David King?
Equilibrium price. So you would do the exact opposite of what you did originally. So the original price was $3, I believe.
Yeah.
So.
Or it was.
What was it?
It was $1. The price was $1, and then there was 99-cent tax.
Right. So.
And here's the inelastic supply and the market equilibrium price.
Okay. So would it be the case that if that 99-cent tax led to the optimal amount of production at 55,000?
Yeah.
Then if you regulated the quantity at 55,000, then the price would end up being 199?
Yeah, 190, yeah.
190,
exactly. So you can see that just plugging this in here, right? You get 1.9 as the, you say 55,000 is equal to 150 minus 50,000 P, and that leads to a price of 1.9. There's an exact equivalence, at least in this simple situation, between the cap and the tax, right? And this is generally true because of the definition of market optimality. As David said, if we charge the right price, that leads to the optimal quantity. If we have the right quantity, that has to occur at the right price. These things are completely equivalent to one another. It's exactly the same as what we talked about last class, that the social planner implementing the optimal quantity is exactly the same as there being the right price. Okay, so this is commonly proposed for pollution, that we should give people give out permits and then allow people to trade these. And what would happen is the people who are most efficient at reducing their pollution will sell their permits to the people who are less efficient. As long as this is efficient, is set at the efficient level of total pollution, the price will be exactly the same as what the tax would be. And this is particularly obvious if rather than giving out the permits, we just held an auction, right? Where people could buy the permits, and the price that would occur at the auction is going to be exactly the same as the tax that would be imposed, right? But this is often proposed instead of a tax, precisely to avoid doing an auction. So the idea is you give the permits to the people who are hurt and who would therefore oppose you politically in imposing the tax, right? So it's basically a way to buy off people who would be politically opposed to the system. This is hard to do with taxes. I mean, in principle, you could charge a Pigouvian tax, raise some revenue, and then just give out the money as bribes to the people who would be opposed to you. But this would look pretty blatantly corrupt, right? So instead, what the government usually does is proposing doing is giving out these permits. Now, these permits are exactly the same as cash, because you could sell them for the equilibrium price in the market, but somehow it looks more fair than just giving out tax revenue. But putting aside the political logic, let's think about whether there's an economic reason why we might want one versus the other. So the basic problem is when you set a tax or when you set a quantity, you don't necessarily know exactly what the private demand and supply are going to be like. You don't know what this private marginal value is going to be like, right? So if the marginal externality created is independent of the amount of the tax, sorry, of the amount, the quantity that's created, it makes a lot of sense to use a tax. So that is, if the marginal cost of the externality is completely flat, it doesn't matter how much is being produced, or if the marginal cost of reducing the quantity is very large, or sorry, is very inelastic, so that if you reduce it by much more, it's going to cost a huge amount. If you reduce it by much less, it's going to cost, it's going to be very cheap to do that, then it's going to make a lot of sense to use the tax, because that lets the market determine the total quantity more efficiently. So an example of this is, imagine that you're doing something like making noise for that's driving your neighbor crazy. It doesn't really matter how many people in the country are doing that, right? Every time someone does that, it causes a certain amount of harm to their neighbor. It's not like we want to regulate the total amount of driving your neighbor crazy to be a certain amount across the country, and then have people trade the right to drive their neighbor crazy. That wouldn't make any sense, because the externality cause doesn't, it's just completely elastic. It just is one unit, no matter who does it, it doesn't aggregate across the country. On the other hand, think about smoking. Smoking might get worse as more people do it, but the problem is that, if we put a cap on the total amount of smoking, there might be some people who are addicts for whom it would be incredibly costly to quit smoking. Right? And so it doesn't make sense to put a cap on the total amount of smoking allowed. It makes a lot more sense to put a tax on smoking so that people can figure out the right amount to adjust, so we don't force the people who just can't quit to quit, because that would be very inefficient. And this is the reason why there's the tort system is used for most small local externalities, because they don't accumulate over all, the whole country, and so it doesn't make sense to put a cap or regulation on them. On the other hand, if the optimal quantity to deal with the externalities is known very clearly, it makes a lot more sense to put a cap on the quantity. So, for example, if the marginal externality is extremely steep, because things just like go to hell if you do have even a little bit more than a certain quantity, or if it's very elastic how much it costs to mitigate in the private sector, then you want to use a quantity control. So an example of this is congestion on a road. So a road is basically completely fine until when there's like, you know, getting up to a certain number of people there. But as soon as it goes over like the threshold where it really gets congested, then everything goes to hell. And basically, the value of being on the road like drops to zero almost immediately, right? Because you're just stuck. I'm sure everyone who's driven much has experienced that, right? On the other hand, and in that case, it makes a lot of sense to just put a cap on the number of people that are allowed to be on the road rather than a price for being on the road. That's why tolls don't work that well. During busy times, it's terrible. During other times, it doesn't matter that someone's on the road. So they don't make a lot of sense. It makes much more sense to put like a total cap on how many people can be on the road in a given time. On the other hand, it didn't make a lot of sense to put a tax on having lead in gasoline and instead to just mandate that cars don't have any lead, because the cost of reducing the lead that's in the gasoline is very flat. It's just, you know, there's a certain amount that it costs to take the lead out of the gasoline, and that doesn't depend on how much of it is in there. So let me show you this on the graph. So suppose on the one hand, we were to have very flat private value and very steep social costs. In this case, we would expect that it's much more efficient to set a price, to set a quantity rather than a price, right? And so how do we see that? Well, imagine that we don't quite know what the private demand looks like. It could be this, it could be that. If we set a quantity, then in these cases, we only get this very small dead weight loss triangle, right? This is what we end up producing, and this would be what is efficient. And so we get a small dead weight loss area there. On the other hand, if we had set the price here, right, we would get this huge dead weight loss area here. And that would be very, very inefficient. On the other hand, if the private value is very inelastic and the social value, social cost is quite elastic, then it should be much more efficient to set a price rather than a quantity, right? So if we set a price, we only get this little dead weight loss area here, whereas if we set a quantity, we get this huge dead weight loss area here. Right? So the more elastic is the private value relative to the social value, the more we want a quantity. The more elastic is the social value relative to the private value, the more we want to use a tax or a price. Now, everything that I've been talking about so far is sort of a public or government-led solution. But some people have suggested that we don't really need to use the government to solve these types of problems, that as long as the property rights are clear, people in the private sector can just come to an efficient bargain about the situation. So imagine you're making a lot of noise at night, and your neighbor hates this. Now, the efficient outcome is that maybe you make a little bit of noise, listen to your music less, but not no noise at all, right? Because, you value